The name of this video is Dielectric Gauss. Integral and case one. In fact, in this video, we are going to study Gauss's theorem in presence of the dielectric materials, both in integral form and in local form, case one, which means the differential form according to definitions we used in FIS 242. Obviously, Gauss's theorem can be written in general in presence of conductors, as well as in presence of dielectric materials. It is always valid. The only difference is that in presence of dielectric materials, as well as conductors, we need to consider the effect of all possible charges in space. On conductors, there will be free charges with a total charge, free charge QF. In dielectric materials, there will be polarization charges with a total polarization charge QP. Therefore, Gauss's theorem will read the flux, as always, through a closed surface capital sigma, which encloses a region capital omega of the three-dimensional Euclidean space, of E, the flux of E, the electric field, dot NdA, is equal to the total charge contained within capital sigma, Q total within capital sigma, the symbol means within capital sigma, divided by, as always, epsilon naught. But what is the total charge? As I just said, this is nothing but the total free charge on all conductors plus the polarization charge QP on inside and on the surfaces of the dielectric materials divided by epsilon naught. Now, we know from our study of dielectric materials what is QP. QP, the polarization charge in general, in integral form in a dielectric material. First of all, let us remember the correct sign, minus. Why is minus? Charge conservation principle. QP is minus the flux through the closed surface capital sigma, which encloses all the dielectric materials we suppose in this case, of what? The polarization vector capital P. So capital P, polarization vector, a dot NdA. If we now choose to plug in this quantity inside this expression up here for QP, multiply everything times epsilon naught, we can rewrite Gauss's theorem as follows. Epsilon naught, I multiply everything time epsilon naught, the left and right hand sides of this equation, and I substitute QP into this equation as well. In addition, let me go straight, let me skip one more step, which is simple. We bring the QP expression substituted to the left-hand side. So we multiply everything by epsilon naught and bring this expression of QP to the left-hand side, therefore obtaining epsilon naught, the flux through capital sigma of E dot NdA. Remember that there is a minus sign, I bring it to the other side, so it becomes plus. I multiply times everything times epsilon naught, and therefore this becomes simply QP with the plus sign because I bring it to the other side. Therefore, it's nothing but the flux through the same surface, capital sigma, which encloses all materials we are considering, including conductors and dielectric materials, of P dot NdA. This quantity has to be equal to, I multiply everything times epsilon naught, so the only thing left on the right hand side is QF, the total free charge, which is present, obviously, on the conducting materials in this case. So now here, on the left-hand side, we can see that we have two fluxes over the same surface capital sigma. Therefore, we can merge them together and rewrite this expression as the flux through capital sigma of a new vector, which we put together here, is going to be epsilon naught times E vector plus P, the polarization vector, this new vector, the flux of this new vector, so dot NdA, gives us the total charge, the total free charge on the conductors, which is QF. By definition, this new vector epsilon naught E plus P is called the vector D, capital D vector. What is this capital D vector? So let's redefine it here. So capital D vector is equal to epsilon naught E plus P. Traditionally, such a vector is called the displacement vector. This definition is due to Maxwell. However, I do not like that definition. What I like is to define this vector as the free auxiliary vector D. The free auxiliary vector D is equal to epsilon naught E, the electric field, plus the polarization field, capital P, vector. Why do I like to call it the free auxiliary vector field D? Free because it is only due to the free charges present on all the conductors in my region of space, capital omega and capital sigma, enclosed by capital sigma. So that is why it's free, because it's only due to QF. So that's the first word. What about auxiliary? It's an auxiliary field, because actually you do not really necessarily need it. The fundamental field in electromagnetism for the electric part of things is E. The vector E, the electric field, is the fundamental field in electromagnetism. In fact, when we perform measurements, what do we measure in real life? We use voltmeters, maybe very accurate ones, like we do in my lab to perform our experiments, to measure potential differences, that is, voltages. We measure potential differences, which allow us, as a consequence, to measure indirectly E. So our observable are voltages, potential differences, which are associated with E and not with D. As we shall see, in fact, E is always irrotational, at least in the static case, whereas D is not. So D is less fundamental, and it's just an auxiliary field that we use. Why is it useful? Why do we want to complicate our life with another field, which I know students always say, is this real? Is this unreal? The real field you want to consider is E. E is what we measure in the lab. D is an auxiliary field, which, however, is super useful. Why is that? Because it only relies on QF. This word, free, which means it relies only on QF, is key because it allows us to solve problems in a much easier fashion than considering E, which intrinsically takes into account for all charges, including the polarization charge. With D, I get rid of that part, a kind of sweeping under the rug, so it's still there, but it allows us to solve problems, as we shall see in a few videos from now, very simply. So it is a useful auxiliary field, but the fundamental field is E. So when you want to understand the physics intuitively and qualitatively, you really want to think about E. D is just useful to solve problems, and is not as fundamental as E. All right. So now that we know all that, how can we derive from this integral form, which is the flux of D is equal QF, and note that there is a difference. In the flux of E, we have the total charge over epsilon naught. In this case, we don't have this division by epsilon naught. Okay, the flux of D is just QF. This is my integral form of Maxwell's equations for D, if you want, okay? Again, it's equivalent to this up here. So this one actually is sufficient to describe all possible electrostatic phenomena. Now, how can we derive the local form, case one, which I remind you from Phys 242, is nothing but the differential form. So, conjecture, if it so happens that, remember that D implicitly depends on capital P, so if both rho free, the charge free density in the volume, in this region enclosed by capital sigma, as well as rho P, so you need to remember that also rho P is part of the game somehow, as I said, we speak sweeping under the rug, but it's still there. If both of these are continuous functions in my region capital omega, and therein they are limited, that is, they do not extend to infinite distance, we conjecture in physics 242 that under these conditions, then it is possible to go to use all the theorems of vector calculus, in this case, the divergence theorem, which is the one associated with Gauss's theorem. And so, if we use the divergence theorem, what can we do? We can rewrite this surface integral from the divergence theorem. So this is the physics. The physics is that this flux is equal to QF. That's the physics of the problem. So the flux of D dot NdA is equal to QF. That's the physics. Before going to physics, let's do some math. The math is, this is equivalent to the volume integral in the region capital omega space in my three-dimensional Euclidean space of the divergence of D, divergence theorem, dV. And now the physics comes into play here. And so the physics, whereas this one is just the math, the physics simply tell us that this has to be equal to the volume integral in capital omega, as we have seen multiple times in 242, of rho free dV. Note that again, I'm not dividing by epsilon naught, which is a typical mistake people do because we don't have that. We multiply times that in this specific case. That's why also sometimes people call D density. You can see many resources out there on the stack exchange and all that. I prefer actually this free auxiliary D definition, which I think is more powerful in my opinion and more pedagogically useful. Anyway, so now that we have this equation here, we have used some math, we used some physics, obviously to do the arbitrariness of capital omega, as always, due to the arbitrariness of capital omega, this can simply be rewritten as the divergence of D equal rho free. So it's similar to the case one for E. In that case, the divergence of E is equal to total rho divided by epsilon naught. In this case, the divergence of D is just rho free. And so this is our integral form of Gauss's theorem for the electric materials for D. And this is the local form case one or differential form, which is possible under these conditions, conjecture of 242. Now in Piazza question, I would like you to prove this from the definition of D, which again is epsilon naught E plus P. That is, what happens if you perform the divergence of this quantity here? You should be able to recover exactly from the divergence of this quantity here. Of this, you should be able to recover this equation here. And I'll let you do it in Piazza. Please do it and show it to me there. Okay, so to recap this video, dielectric Gauss, integral and case one, which means integral form and differential form, which is what we call case one. Gauss's theorem for the electric field is always valid. However, when we have both conductors and dielectric materials, we need to take into account for both QF and QP divided by epsilon naught. Simple Gauss's theorem. We have proven that QP is the minus flux of P dot NdA, the polarization vector. Therefore, we can substitute it, bring everything to the left-hand side, multiply by epsilon naught. By doing so, we define a new vector, which is the free auxiliary vector D, which is epsilon naught E plus P. The flux of this vector is just the free charges. That's why it's called free. Auxiliary because it's not as general and as fundamental as E, which is what typically we measure indirectly by means of voltage measurements in our experiments. Conjecture, if rho F and rho P are continuous and limited in this region of space, then we can use the divergence theorem, which is math. The physics is given by QF, Gauss's theorem for D. This gives us divergence of D equal rho F. And I ask a question for Piazza. In the next videos, we are going to look at the circulation properties in dielectric materials, both in integral and differential form as well. That's it.